It is one of my most favorite pieces of music of all time. Sonny Stitt and the Sonny Stitt Quartet with Blues Greasy. I could listen to this nonstop for years and still find something great about it when I listen to it once more. Stitt, of course, is on alto and tenor sax, Bobby Timmons on piano, Edgar Willis on bass guitar, and Kenny Dennis on drums. This was recorded in 1957, in keeping with my oldies but great goodies, which is an absolute favorite of mine too. Revisit work well done by all these musicians and work that withstands a test of time. So, you know who I am. I'm not sure who I am today, but I'm sure that I was yesterday. This is Eutrice Leed, and you're listening to Leed Stories. I came down with a really terrible case of tonsillitis, and my doctor said, "Forget it, don't talk too much." I mean, that's a curse. He might as He pronounced a curse on me. Don't talk too much. So today's my first day out. Still have a little while to go, but I guess over the weekend I'll get the knots tied up and everything will be okay with my throat again. So the idea, this is your program. You are taking the program wherever you want it to go. I'm kind of like a referee, and that's all I'm supposed to do is to just guide the conversation along and, a nudge here and a nudge there. And before you know it, we have people talking to each other about things that matter to them. And actually, in many cases, they matter to us too, all of us. It was a horrific week. We hunkered down as best we could, and we got through it. But I tell you, the pictures that are coming to us from the Bahamas, and now at points beyond, many points beyond, that really weren't covered as such because they weren't seen as, the center point of the stories. So we will see, because now we're getting aftermath reactions and rediscovering what is still going on, how people are trying to cope with a really treacherous storm. And we'll see. I was asked whether, what will should we do? In the first instance, what we need to do, I would advise, is to wait for instruction. Because there are many things that are happening, and in the face of a calamity like this, the people who are delivering aid and who are trying to just get an idea of how severe a problem they have on their hands, they're best able to direct the traffic. So we wait and see, because there's enough aid, at least as we understand it, emergency food and so forth. There's enough of that to carry people through. But please keep in mind, this is a logistical nightmare. And while people have to eat, others are searching still for bodies. And still others are trying to get a handle on what's to be done next. So it's things are moving at a furious pace, even though it doesn't look like it. But people are working feverishly to just set a, what can I call it, a sensible and logical way of operating in the midst of all of this chaos. And the one thing we should feel reasonably sure about is that aid is getting to people who desperately need it. They're finding ways to find them and to get the help that they need to them. Of course, this is going to be picking up as people make assessments of the damage and how best to deal with the damage. So they will tell the general public how best to assist in the process of helping. Okay, 888-874-4888 is the number to call. This is your program. And you take this where you want it to go, and you ought to have some reason for stating where you want it to go. Harvey from Berkeley, you're on.
Hello, wonderful Utrees.
Hey, great, Harvey. What's going on by you?
Well, I hope you're feeling better soon, and we're all going to send our good thoughts and wishes that you recover as fast as possible.
Thank you. They're sure. they're very necessary.
And
they seem to be working.
We all love you very much, Utrees.
Thank you.
So it's been reported that by 2025, two-thirds of the world's population may be facing severe water shortages due to climate destabilization and other serious problems like the poisoning of our freshwater aquifers by fracking for oil and methane. And I have a suggestion that can bring clean, fresh water to many of the world's drought-stricken and fracked areas using readily available off-the-shelf technology. And I call them atmospheric water harvesting storage towers. Harvesting water from the atmosphere is an open cycle. Is an open cycle because once the water is harvested, it's used for a variety of purposes and then returned to the atmosphere. And so water storage towers are tanks that are mounted on large steel legs that you can actually, and you can actually see them above small towns. You've seen water storage towers, Utrees, haven't you?
Sure. Live near one.
Very good. Well, one of the reasons that they mount the water storage towers on steel legs instead of placing them on the ground is because they use the natural force of gravity to pump the water down the pipe to the ground, and where the waters could be used for things like fighting fires and so on and so forth. But and industrial atmospheric water harvesting machines, the idea is to place these industrial atmospheric water harvesting machines, which produce thousands of gallons an hour, on top of the water tanks. And they could be powered by placing solar panels on top of the water harvesting machines, as well as around the towers and around the legs. And and also quiet, bird-safe wind turbines placed around the tops and sides of the water tower can also provide electricity to power the industrial atmospheric water harvesting machines. And you can have utility-sized batteries placed either on the ground or at the underside of the water tank to store energy for nighttime use so that the water harvesting machines can work at night as well. And also you can place water purifying devices so that the water is purified for drinking, cooking, and irrigation. And this will take government support to finance these water harvesting storage towers, they could bring millions. They can help to bring water to millions of people who are in areas around the world who have water shortages. So that's basically the concept: is utilize these off-the-shelf technologies, water storage towers, atmospheric water harvesting devices, solar panels, wind turbines, purification equipment, and batteries to build these water harvesting solar-powered water harvesting storage towers to bring water to people who don't have any.
Well, thank you, Harvey. Always something that we could think about and then, to the best of our ability, get moving on. Thank you so much for contributing that today. Dave from New York, you're on the air.
Hi there, you treat.
Hi there.
I've never
called
in to a radio show, so I might be a little nervous. But anyway,
that's okay.
I've listened to you for a long time. I'm calling about a film I saw this week called Cold Case Hammarskjöld. And what it's about is this Danish filmmaker went back to look at how Dag Hammarskjöld's plane had crashed after he had given a lot of speeches about how corporations and the imperialist countries were trying to control the newly independent African countries. Okay, so how this all started was with a Swedish man whose father had worked for Hammarskjöld at the UN, and they both began to look into what happened to that plane, and they found all kinds of people, interviewed mercenaries involved with South Africa and Rhodesia and a lot of other countries. And it looks like his plane was actually shot down by a dual citizen of Belgium and Great Britain flying a small fighter jet launched from an airfield that was owned by a Belgian corporation mining in the Congo. They went on and began to look at other things connected with this, and it pointed to a South African intelligence agency that was kind of used by British intelligence and the CIA. They kept on looking, and they found out that these guys in this South African intelligence agency were also running private clinics, or low-cost clinics throughout Africa, and they were not medical personnel, but they were injecting, you know, African women mostly with what was probably, you know, AIDS virus. So this went from looking for what happened to Hammarskjöld to showing the whole imperialist and corporate attempts to control Africa. And it's a very interesting film, and I would highly recommend it.
Now, is it showing at this time only in certain places, or
yes,
does it have a fairly good distribution?
Obviously, your local, you know, multiplex is not going to show it. It is showing at TSL in Hudson. That's Time and Space Limited in Hudson, New York. But It may be available maybe on Vimeo or one of those independent movie places.
Well, thank you for calling in.
I mean, it's really enlightening.
Thank you so much, Dave.
Thank you for having me.
That was valuable information to share. E from Edgewater, you're on the air.
Hi, Eutrice. I see you survived the hurricane.
I did. But then I got smacked with tonsillitis.
Oh, boy. Well, if they don't get you one way, they get you with something else, right?
All you have to do is keep moving. Just try to keep moving. That's all.
That's right. We got to keep goals forward somehow. Yeah. I ended up staying because I kept watching the forecast, and I figured looked like it wasn't going to get close to the coast. So I made it through Irma. I figured I could get through this one. So I just stayed, and it wasn't really more than like a severe thunderstorm, really. It was what it was like. But what I saw happened
just
to...
Just bursts of intense bursts, but not many. Of the hurricane down this way, although that was not what was forecast originally. What was forecast was it was going to be a horror story. So we were spared, and we are so lucky to have been spared.
Yeah, I agree. And if it wasn't for the Bahamas, who knows, nothing would have probably stopped it from slowing it down. But it really was very strange to me that a 185-mile-an-hour wind storm could suddenly just stop for almost 2 days directly over an island, little island that's out there in the Atlantic, and this big giant storm would be right directly over it. I mean, this is speculation on my part, but if you had the ability to control a hurricane some way with technology, you can make it do what it just did to the Bahamas, then there would be no more need for Scud missiles and Patriot missiles and atomic bombs anymore. You could just conduct wiping out whole countries with natural disasters, and nobody would know any of the better.
Well, this has been at least rumored to have been the plan developed quite a while ago to use what looks like the forces of nature to the unpracticed eye, but really a new way of waging war and conducting horrific attacks on people via the weather. So this, what you're mentioning, is something that has been popping up all along with a sense of, this is nothing to play with. This might be real. A real way of controlling the weather and the other forces of nature to conduct warfare. It's a new area that apparently is attractive.
Right. Now, you could go all the way back to 1967, I believe, when Lyndon Baines Johnson said it himself. The one who controls the weather could control the world. And this is 60 years ago. So I'm sure technology in 2019 has reached this point where maybe this is possible, what he was talking about. And not only hurricanes, but earthquakes, tornadoes, fires, floods, all these things can be generated through technology. And we should be more alert or more conscious of these things could be possibly happening, and this is the way they're getting around looking bad, because we can just blame it on Mother Nature. It had nothing to do with mankind doing anything to their fellow man. This is what I'm afraid of, and if it's true, then we're really in a bad place. this point in time.
Well, something to think about. Thanks for calling in, E, today.
Thank you, Yatrice. Have a nice, nice weekend.
Thank you. Jose from Rosedale, you're on the air.
Greetings, my professor.
Hello.
Greetings.
Greetings to you.
And ancestral blessings be upon you. It's good to hear you up and about. And I hope the ancestors preserve you for us for a very, very long time.
Thank you. I share the same view.
Thank you.
Please
thank you, my
friend. Preserve me for a long time.
Yes, yes. Now, you have a very interesting program today. It's kicked off pretty good. And I was listening to, oh, by the way, I must send my condolences to all the victims of Hurricane Dorian. And I pray that they will get the kind of relief, the kind of help that they need to try and get themselves back on their feet again. All right? And I also want to send my condolences to the family and the people of Zimbabwe for the loss of President Robert Mugabe. I was told by a friend that he passed away yesterday, and I heard it myself on the BBC. And you know, if we don't talk about those leaders, those freedom fighters that has put their lives on the line and struggled and fought and died for us, no one else would. They will tell the story, but they'll tell it their way. And so I've been listening to some of the local programs here, and no one has even talked about the passing of this great man. And so it is sad.
I've heard some discussions, but nothing very intensive.
Mm-hmm.
We will be pursuing this because it's a significant event.
It is. And we have to make it that. You know, I was last night I was talking to a friend of mine, but I was looking for something, going through a lot of papers that I have here. You know, us old-timers, we become hoarders. And I ran into this program. Just by accident, I ran into it. And it says, the President of the Republic of Zimbabwe, His Excellency Robert Mugabe. And this is a visit that he made to New York on September 7th. Which will be tomorrow, and he passed away on September 6th, right? And I took the program up and I was looking at it, December 12th movement with Dr. Jeffries and all those folks were there at the Mount Olivet Church in Harlem. And I said, can you imagine this? The brother was saying goodbye. I interpreted it that way, right? I mean, I guess I'm entitled to it. He was telling me goodbye. And so this is a brother that I hope that we spend some time really going into who he really was, what he stood for, and the formidable forces that he came up against. Because there are some who want to minimize the role that he played in the struggle for Zimbabwe. And so I hope we will find the time to go into it and to tell our story ourselves and start letting others tell our story for us, right? And so also, I would like to just say this. We talk about I think this past week or the week before, I was talking about the death of this, the so-called death of this this pervert that they say committed suicide. And I know you don't, you're not into the conspiracy theory and things like that, but after living in this world and in this country for all these many years and knowing American history, knowing what the Europeans are capable of doing, we can't as a people sit by and say that Europeans white folks are not capable of doing the type of thing that we imagine. The most we can do as little people, as common people, we don't have the ability to do the research and to get to the bottom of many of the mysteries that happened before our very face. The most we can do, we have a brain, we have a mind, we can think, we can analyze, but we can't get to the depth of where these fellows, where these things are hidden. The things that they have done, the folks that they have killed, have assassinated, the thing, the destruction of people's whole economy, the deaths that we have seen, and they want us to believe that these are accidents. The folks, the freedom fighters on the African continent, in the Caribbean and so forth, how many of them have died mysteriously? And folks who want us to believe that, no, these are just accidents. So when we open our mouth and we come and we say we don't believe so and so and so, to ask us for proof, it is difficult for us to come with proof. Right? But these things, as I said, if we study the history, we see how the enemy operate, then we know that these things are possible. And as someone mentioned about the control, whoever control the weather, right? What they control the world. Well, not only the weather, but the diseases. There are so many diseases that are created in labs and so forth. And these diseases are used as a means to bring nations to their heels, especially those who don't have the power to counteract these diseases. The African continent don't have the means of doing the research and the development and of creating vaccines and anti-vaccines and so forth to support ourselves. Whatever is handed down to us, we have to accept it. And that is why I am worried now about when the Europeans, including the United States and Britain and so, when they get their act together and they get the chance to fully concentrate on the African continent, what is going to happen to us? Because already we have a man sitting in number 10 Downing Street that he knows what he feels about the African continent, the former so-called former colonies. He has said it in so many words. You have a man in the House of Lords, they said. His name is Lord, Lord something. He said that Africa should be, Zimbabwe should be recolonized. And when it got down on him, he acted as if he was making a joke. No, we don't joke about things like that, especially when they have the means of doing these things. Africa, we don't have the means to prevent a invasion of our continent and the enslavement of our continent. We don't have the means of preventing it. We don't even manufacture a slingshot on the African continent to defend ourselves. If all the weapons that they're using there to kill each other, just like what is happening in South Africa right now, so many Africans are killing each other, and I don't understand what is going on, because they're calling Africans foreigners, and I want to know, how can an African be a foreigner on African soil? How can that be? And these boundaries and these borders were not created, they were created by the Europeans. So I am worried and I'm very concerned about what is going to happen to the African continent and to those of us in the Caribbean. As you can see, one little storm here has devastated so many islands in the Caribbean. How can they recover? And when they do recover, everything will be there in the hands of those who are used to controlling and dominating the economy and people's lives. So these are things that very much concern me, my professor, and I don't think our people really, truly understand the predicament that we are in.
So, well, you certainly gave us enough to think about so that we should be pursuing many of the aspects that you raised. Mm-hmm. This is what this time is for, to...
Yes.
Get people to start thinking about things in other than a superficial way, to really stop and think.
Yes.
That's my anthem. Think.
Yes.
Think a lot.
And then the program for giving us the time to, you know, giving us the people the time to give vent to our feelings, because it is hard to to see what is happening and see the danger that faces us as a people. And we know that we have no friends. We have no friends in high or low places to help us when the enemies are started moving en masse against us. We have no friends.
That's what Dr. Clark said so many times over so many years. We have no friends. Yes. Thank you so much for calling in today.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Ed from Queens, you're on the air.
Yeah, good afternoon, you Trace. How are you feeling?
Okay.
My tonsils
are almost right back to normal. Almost.
Well, it's good to hear. I'm glad you made it through this unusual storm that we had, hurricane, superstorm, whatever they're calling it. I totally agree with one of the previous callers. I definitely believe some type of technology and weather control is afoot, especially with global warming and the advent of increased temperatures. I think it'd probably be a lot easier for them, the powers that be, to control the weather. And I was in the military for 4 years, involved in certain things, and this was several years ago, but the technology was being developed then. So that being said, you got to watch out. Basically, I call because I'd like to applaud the people of China. I really think that this is, if you pay attention to this, this is really showing the power of the people and what type of influence they can bring forward, especially if they act together. 1 million people protested and got the Chinese government, or at least the Hong Kong government, outside of Beijing, to drop this law that was going to make it harder to prosecute certain people out of Hong Kong. And I applaud them for it. And American people need to take a look and really activate the power of the people, because the Chinese government is a very repressive government. It's been a very repressive government.
Very much so.
For many years. And the people forced them from Tiananmen Square till now. And we need to take a lesson from that. I remember earlier this week, you were talking about the tear gas at the border and how you were surprised that there was no outrage by the American people. And it doesn't surprise me, unfortunately, because Americans are weak. Americans, they've lost the fire. They've lost the ability to access the moral high ground and force this government to do what it's supposed to do for the people. Because the government only exists at the bequest of the people. It doesn't exist for itself. But for the past at least 50 years, it seems like it's been existing for itself and to service a small minority of people. But in retrospect, that's what this country is based in. That's what this country started from. I say it time and time again. This country was developed by a bunch of small white landowners for their benefit. And the only reason that is here is because they didn't want to pay taxes and they wanted to keep all the profits to themselves. They killed the people that were here when they found that the people here wouldn't conform and do the work that they wanted to do. And then they brought people from other places to do the work and then enslaved them. So, I mean, we got to wake up. We got to wake up and we got to access the power of the people. And I just, once again, I wanted to applaud China. You really don't hear a lot about it in the news. It's mentioned here and there, but the in-depth reporting I haven't heard on any station, not even some of the stations that I thought would make an in-depth reporting about it. But then again, they want to keep that quiet. They want to keep that quill because they want to keep the people stupid, for want of a better word. But that's what I wanted to say.
Thanks so much for calling in.
Thank you.
Thank you. Veronica from Brooklyn, you're on the air.
Hey,
good day.
I love you.
Thank you,
UAM,
Veronica.
UAM.
Stay here.
I was calling because I've been a stranger for a while, but I am calling to mention, it seems that many of our heroes, I'm going to use the example of Malcolm X. He said, be careful when they tell you who your friends are. They will tell you your friends are your enemies and your enemies are your friends. I noticed that I'm going to run through a couple of names. You know, it seems like all of our heroes, the majority of them, had to go to jail or prison to become or to be let in to lead the people. Winnie Mandela is one of the people I will mention. Mandela, 27 years. Khalid Muhammad. Martin Luther King. Asada Shakur. MOVE members. Black Panthers. And Neely Fuller said, if you do not understand white supremacy, things will only confuse you. Now, I remember Kwame Ture. You know, he said he was jailed so many times and he was not going to accept that anymore. And these people have followed and did what they said was lawful. And they still, you know, they still suffer. You know, I feel shame that that any Panther is in prison to this day. That any senior, because they have already proven that recidivism does not occur in people over 65, yet we have people doing life sentences for nonviolent crimes. That itself is a crime against humanity. I intend, before Robert Mugabe passed away, I did not know that he was in prison also. It is a shame that such an educated, loving person that decided that he would share the land equally, and they still had a problem with that. Malema, he is a hero. And the sanctions, I want them to lift the sanctions off Zimbabwe. They're saying that he did all these things, but sanctions hurt the poor people, not the elephants fighting. It always hurts the poor, the young, the people that need medicine, the people that need help. And that was on my mind. I thought of the Million Youth March. You know, it brought together the Native American. It brought together the Latino. It brought together the African American, the downtrodden. And the reason and all the accomplishments seem to have been gone astray, pushed, because we are right back to before it occurred. You know, they have, it seems the governments have conspired, which is nothing unusual, to make the people disagree again, make the people not communicate or use Facebook to distract us. And I said, you know, how dare they tell us that Robert Mugabe was no good? When I said, well, how can they compare the liar in chief? I mean, it's not even a comparison, you know, to the humanity of a Robert Mugabe. And that,
you know,
is my fault.
I have a little something I want to contribute here. And that is, as thirsty as we are for information about ourselves and our history and our leadership and our long quest for freedom, we're also very, very idealistic. And this is where we disengage with the reality that we're living. We hold on to a reality that simply either didn't exist or doesn't exist or shouldn't exist. We let go of the reality we need to hold on to more than anything else, which is we're still in struggle. It is not over.
That's right.
Struggle is an unending thing.
That's right.
And we have not really understood the value of strategy, analysis, studying, and creating for ourselves alternatives. We are still applying in 2019 some of the maxims of the 1950s and 40s and 30s.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
So, and we expect a different result. So it means that either we're not inclined to study our own history and to understand what that history is for. It's for teaching what the next steps ought to be. How do we develop?
So we do not repeat the mistakes of the past.
And we repeat them all the time.
Yes, because I'm watching, I'm observing, let's take New York City, I'm observing de Blasio and Cuomo, who I've never voted for. They have not done the Tale of Two Cities, and they're only catering to the rich. They don't care about anyone that's not rich, as far as I'm concerned. You know, so they prop up, you know, people that look like everyone, but yet they do nothing and they're not involved in any struggle for anyone in the community. As
their struggle has already been achieved in large measure. The struggle was that the generation, just one, not many, just one generation ago, these same groups were castigated as being on the lower rung of the ladder and insulting the rest of the group by their slavish affinity to white supremacy. Just a little while ago, Mario Cuomo.
That's right. That's right.
Okay, so you don't even have to track back 5 and 6 and 10 generations. They entered and they achieved the goals that they were seeking.
Yes.
In just one generation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So when we start talking about how do we all get together and plan? Again, it repeats the same cycle. We ignore history. History tells us over and over and over again. It is all well and good. It is very important to have a spirit of cooperation. But in politics, you can't have that and succeed. You can't have that approach.
No, definitely not. We have to leave the plantation.
Unless whoever you're coalescing with can produce evidence of siding with the sufferer over and over again. That we don't have that evidence. So who is naive? Politics is a very difficult thing, a very strategic kind of war. All wars are strategic, actually.
Mm-hmm.
But we keep hoping, we go in praying that, you know, we shall overcome. It doesn't work that way. And we refuse to understand.
And it never did.
Yeah, we are overcome, but we shall not overcome. Not that easily.
Yes. Yes.
I think we should change the song to say, "We are overcome. We are overcome." That's the story. Because our strategies haven't changed. Our plans haven't changed. Our mindset hasn't changed. If you talk to the average person out here who would swear on a stack of Bibles that he or she is with it, current, informed, And you ask them a very simple question. What could you point to today as a major strategy that has been won? A major one. What are you going to say? Meanwhile, while you're stuck there with this idea of suffering being necessary and you know how we will stick it through, even though we should be done with these kinds of phrases.
Yes, I was expressing
in one generation. Please keep that in mind. In one generation, the power has shifted from Mario Cuomo. And by the way, how did he come to power? On the strength of the black vote, the manipulation of the black vote. And he has a son who is now about to seriously consider running for president.
Exactly. See, this is how I saw it before.
That unless there's a strategy.
Exactly.
And you can't
and that
beat
is strategy.
For having a strategy.
Mm-hmm.
So there we are.
I observed also, I learned that colleges were free throughout New York City until blacks and Latinos attended. So it is possible to do those things as having free college, not Hitler, Clinton. She says, okay, we can have free colleges because if you go for 4 years, now you have to work for 4 years. They didn't say, it also says you have to work 16-hour shifts, 5 days a week, or things of that nature. Some people would not be able to maintain their children or their household with those things. But those are some
and
of
how
the things.
Did she come to how did she come into this position of power, singular power? Because now she's on her own.
Because of Barack Obama allowing her to become Secretary of Hate when she did not earn or deserve the position. That's my thought.
Oh, well, we have so far to go, but we have to go back to the basics, re-examine for contradictions. Where we find contradictions, we just take those things out of our consciousness and move beyond them. But we can't succeed with this "we shall overcome" business. No, and being kind. No, kindness is not part of the equation here. What's part of the equation is you have a plan, you have a strategy that backs up your plan that would, within reason, yield a predictable result in your favor. And you don't stop. Every group does it. Every single group. That's how they get along in life. They have a plan. We just, like the flotsam and jetsam floating on top of the water. Wherever the current carries us, that's where we are. It is so self-destructive.
Definitely.
But thank you so much, Veronica, for calling in today and contributing and reminding us that we're off course.
The struggle never, ever stops. Continuous from the day we give birth until we have accomplished our goals.
As the saying says, to quote Mugabe's people who struggled, "Aluta continua."
Luta continua.
Thank you. David,
thank you.
From Brooklyn, you're on the air.
Hello, your choice. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon to you.
What's at the top of my mind is I was coming to think about all the political things that are going on with the coming presidential election. And what is coming up to me is what I believe is the fact that the people, that is the mass of people in the United States, have no party. Have no party. The two divisions of the one party, Republican and Democrat, and do not represent the interests of the mass of people. They only represent those at the top, the ruling class, the oligarchs, the corporations, and whatnot. So the people are deceived into thinking that they're a part of the parties that they have not gone in the interest of the people. So this is a way that the people are duped. There are no viable other parties around in all the divisions or states of the country, just a few. And so the only viable one is the one party, Republican-Democrat party, and it does not represent the interests of people who live here. So people have to get it. That's why half the country is poor and they're poor, and half the country where people can vote don't bother to vote at all. So, you know, people need to get that. We live in a place where everything is turned upside down. Propaganda and is king here. We call things by the wrong names. We call the War Department, it goes around the world starting and suppressing people with imperialism. We call it the Defense Department. It's not the Defense Department, it's the War Department. We call the Education Department or Border Education, where it's not that, it's the Training Department. Training people to fit in and go along with the status quo to do what the goal is, which is to enrich the few at the expense of the money. So, you know, people need to understand. I know it's difficult because the propaganda is so good. You have people working against their own interests. And I'm talking about not only the so-called white people and black people. The ones at the top are so good at scamming the people, playing a game on them, and getting away with it, and nobody seems to understand what's going on. So that's what's on my mind today. The people have no party.
Amen to that. That's my vote. My vote is you are 1,000 times right on that score. We have no party. And when you look at the severity of the problems that we are confronting, we can't begin to fight because we have nothing to fight with. We have tons and tons of things to fight for, but we have nothing to fight with. So it will be a while before we actually begin to tackle this problem. But you're so right, David. Thank you so much for calling in. That brings us to the end of our program for today. And I want you to feel at home here, to express your mind, to free your mind. And let the chips fall where they may. We're all grown. We can tolerate a difference of opinion every now and then. But we are getting to the point, I think, if we work this right, we will get to the point of seeing each other's point of view. We don't have to agree. That is not required. But we should try to listen to what the other is saying. And whether we find somewhere where we can work together, and that, to me, you stand a bigger chance of working together if you have a better understanding of issues, irrespective of the ways we are encouraged to define struggle in terms of race, in terms of class and whatnot. Is it a good idea? Does it sound sensible? Is it correct? Is it correct for this time? Are we prepared and willing to work at improving our society? It's the weekend. Surround yourselves with people who add positive dimension to your life. Astutely avoid those who don't. You don't have the time to waste on people who are just blustering. They're just into bluster, not action. And we'll see each other on Monday. Bye-bye.